By dark of night, Jesus was arrested and taken away. He faced a trial filled with false accusations and hate. They mocked him, beat him, and then executed him by crucifixion. Crucifixion was a punishment reserved for the most serious of criminals. 7-inch nails were driven through his hands and through his feet. His feet were nailed so his knees were bent at about a 45-degree angle, and once his legs gave out, his weight transferred to his arms, dragging his shoulders from their sockets. The elbows and wrists followed. He began to have trouble breathing and eventually suffocated, and heart failure followed. Jesus felt the process of death creeping through his every tissue. With one last surge of strength, he pressed his torn feet against the nails, straightened his legs, took a last breath, and uttered his last words, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." To make sure of his death, a soldier drove a spear into his ribs, through the pericardium and into the heart. Immediately came out a mixture of blood and water. His disciples watched their Jesus as he suffered and spoke and breathed his last. Jesus was surely dead. His body was laid to rest in a borrowed tomb. And because Jesus had spoken some words about rising on the third day, a large stone was rolled before the entrance of the tomb and a Roman seal was placed upon it. If anyone broke that seal, it meant their instant death. A Roman guard was also posted because no one had ever seen anyone raised from the dead, so there might be an attempt by his disciples to steal the body and claim that he has risen. So they put the guard there. His disciples, they slipped away. It was midweek, the time of the observance of unleavened bread. It's interesting that the final observance of Jesus' death is one that focuses on bread. Remember, Jesus said that he's the bread of life. And the observance was one of unleavened bread, bread that was not risen, but Jesus, the bread of life, was soon to rise. And that observance had a Sabbath time where no work or travel was to occur. It was called a Sabbath time. And then within just a few days later, at the end of the week, the true Sabbath came, and again, no work or travel was to occur. So the disciples were together for the observance and then for the Sabbath. They gathered not just though for the observance for the Sabbath, but they gathered out of fear. Haters had taken and crucified their leader. So the disciples gathered in a room behind locked doors. Some of the women followers of Jesus were anxious to properly prepare the deceased body of their dear Lord. And that with the observance of the Sabbath, which by the way added up to about 3 days, in the breaking light of early morning, the women made their way to the tomb to prepare the body of their dead master, Jesus. But when they arrived at the tomb, the stone was rolled away. And an angel announced to them, "Jesus has risen from the dead, just as he said. Now go and tell the others." Please say with me, "Jesus has risen." Jesus has risen. Again, Jesus has risen. Now, what do you think, once he was risen, what do you think Jesus would do? Where would he go? Maybe to the synagogue or to the greatest of synagogues to show himself. No, we find him once again on the road. He's risen from the dead, resurrected from the grave. He has the power to be transported any way he desires. He can get an angel to give him a ride, better than the Uber or the original Lyft. Something maybe we thought would be in style, but instead we find the resurrected Jesus backtracking from the cross, from the tomb, back on the road, back toward Jerusalem. There's a story about one time the Pope flew into the airport to lead the celebration of Easter at a great cathedral. His plane landed and pulled up to the plane a beautiful brand new limousine. And the driver got out and opened the door in the back and said, please get in. And the Pope said, boy, this is a nice looking car. He said, yes, it's brand new. You'll be the first one to ride in it. Pope said, well, you know what? I haven't driven for a while. I've never driven one of these. Would you mind if I drove and you got in the back? No, we don't know. The glass was tinted. He said, well, you're the Pope, sure. So he got in the back, and the Pope got behind the wheel, and he took it out, and he got on the highway, and he's thinking to himself, I'm going to see what this thing can do. So he pushed the pedal down a little bit, and he went through a speed trap. Cop pulls out, lights are flashing, siren's going, and so the Pope sees it, he pulls over and he looks down his window. And the officer walks over and he looks in there and he says, excuse me just a minute. He goes back to his car and he gets on the mic and he says, Sarge, you gotta help me, I got a problem. What's up? Well, I pulled over somebody and I think they're pretty important. I don't know what to do. He said, is it the mayor? Did you pull the mayor? He said, no, he's got to be more important than that. He said, well, did you pull over the governor? No. Is the president in town? He didn't know? No. Well, who is it? I don't know who it is, but whoever it is, the Pope's driving him around. Jesus didn't ride in on a stallion or a chariot driven in by the Pope or even carried in by angels. He walked back on the very roads that took him to the cross. And he made a number of appearances. We read of one in Emmaus, along the road to Emmaus, which is about 7 miles from Jerusalem. There were two men walking along, talking about the events that had happened, and Jesus came alongside them, and without recognizing him, we're not sure why, maybe they were withheld from that, or maybe they were looking downcast, and they talked about it. Jesus explained to them all the things about himself that had to be fulfilled in the scriptures, and at the end they invited him to dinner, and he sat down, and he took the bread, and blessed it, and broke it. They recognized who it was, and he disappeared. Only to be followed by another appearance. In John 20, we read about this. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, that's Sunday today, or Resurrection Sunday, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side, then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Okay, it's Sunday evening, Resurrection Day evening, and the disciples are together. Remember, they're hiding with the doors locked, fearing the Jewish leaders who took Jesus and did that to him might do the same to them. And then suddenly, Jesus is standing before them. Just think how scary that moment must have been. The disciples' emotions were already at their highest level. They're filled with fear, and they've locked themselves in this room, and suddenly a figure, a man, appears in the room. And suddenly, appearing before them is their dead master who is now risen. No wonder Jesus' first words with peace, kind of like, it's okay, calm down, it's me. And Jesus says, then showed them his hands and his side to show the proof that it was him. And it says their fearing and grieving was instantly replaced by rejoicing, for they had seen the risen Lord Jesus. Please shout out with me, Jesus is risen. Jesus is risen. It goes on in verses 24 to 25. But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, we have seen the Lord. They said to them, unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and I put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe. Now watch Jesus. In 26 through 28. A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe. And Thomas answered him, my Lord and my God. So it's a week later, 7 days later, after Jesus appeared to the other disciples, and Thomas is saying, I've got to see it for myself. 7 miles later, 7 days later, Jesus could have showed up on the spot, but he waited 7 days. Have you ever had to wait 7 days for something or more? For test results? Or for something in your life that needs changing? As you waited through your pain and you waited through depression? 7 days, 7 miles. That's a biblical number of completion. And Jesus shows up. They're in the house again, and Thomas this time was with them, and this time the doors are again locked, and suddenly again, a figure, a man, Jesus appears in the room. And again, Jesus is calling them with peace. Again, calm down, just me again. And he continued. And he said to Thomas, put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe. There are a couple of powerful points in this story, in this account. One is you cannot put a finger into hand wounds where nails are, but where nails were. Thomas, I'm back from the grave. I have risen from the dead, and I want you to see something. No more nails. Look, Thomas, they're not here. Put your finger where the nails were, past tense. Put your finger where I paid the price for sin. Put your finger where the sin and shame were. Put your finger where my enemies thought they had victory over me. Hey, Thomas, no more nails. Shout it out, no more nails. No more nails. There are two wonderful parts of there being no more nails. The first is there were no more nails for Jesus. This is the Jesus spoken of in John 3, 16 and 17. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. This is the Jesus spoken of in Matthew 1, 21. When it says, the angel says, you'll give birth to a son, you'll give him the name Jesus, which means Joshua or conqueror, because he will save his people from their sins. See, the shadow of the nails of the cross were already cast upon even that manger bed. This is the Jesus spoken of in John 1:29. The next day, John the baptizer, saw Jesus coming toward him and said, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. This is the Jesus spoken of in 1 Peter 2:24. It says, and he himself bore our sin in his body on the cross. Jesus Christ, God's one and only Son, Jesus Christ, God's sinless Son, Jesus Christ, God's spotless Lamb, Jesus Christ, born for one purpose, to die, to bear the sins of all people, and to bear the punishment, the price for all sin. Jesus Christ, sent to be the sin-bearer, the final sacrificial Lamb, to be slain for the sins of all people. Jesus, who purposely and willingly and lovingly allowed himself to be falsely accused, mocked, beaten within an inch of his life, and horribly and painfully crucified. Jesus, who willingly stretched himself upon that cross and allowed soldiers to drive nails into his hands and feet, and allowed a soldier to shove a spear into his side. Jesus, who suffered and died an agonizing death. Jesus, whose dead body was taken down and laid in a borrowed grave. Jesus, whose dead body was placed in a dark tomb. Jesus, whose tomb had a huge, heavy boulder rolled across the opening, a Roman seal set, and a squad of soldiers positioned. And yes, yes, Jesus Christ, who 3 days later, just as he said, walked out of that grave alive forever. Amen?
Amen.
The whole purpose of his coming into the world was finished. It was completed. The whole purpose of his life and mission was finished and completed. And Jesus rose and walked away from that grave, and he walked back to Jerusalem and showed again and again that he was alive. He showed women. He showed the disciples. He showed some 12 different groups, from one person to 500 at one time. He showed that he had indeed risen risen from the dead, and that his life and mission of paying for the penalty for the sins of all was done. Then and now and forever, look at his hands, look at his feet. Jesus has no more nails. Say it, no more nails. The enemies did their best to destroy Jesus. The enemies did their best to stop Jesus. They did their best, but their best is swallowed up in the plan and the power of Jesus. They drove nails into his hands and feet. But what held him for a time, for a reason, for a purpose, what held Jesus to that cross doesn't hold him anymore. Amen?
Amen.
He is risen. He is alive. And he walked back to Jerusalem as walking up and down these aisles today. What held him does not hold him anymore. Easter, Resurrection Day, is a day of no more nails for Jesus. Say that. No more nails for Jesus. You see him? No more. The second thing that happened there was no more nails for you and for me. Nails, the crucifixion of that day, was the ultimate punishment for offenses committed by a guilty party. And the Bible says that you and I and every human of all time is guilty of sin and sins. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." And the Bible states that because of those sins, there's an earned wage of payment for those sins. Romans 6:23 says the wages of that sin is death. The price is death, physical, spiritual, eternal death without God. But God. Romans 5:8 says, "But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us." But God, knowing our sin and our condemned situation, but God demonstrates his own love for us, for me, for you, all of us in this. But God, while we were yet sinners, sent Jesus to die for us in our place for our sins, to lay himself as a sinless Lamb of God, lovingly and deliberately and purposely upon a cross reserved for the guilty. And Jesus, the one and only sinless one, stretched his arms and legs upon that cross, again allowed those soldiers to drive those nails that we deserve to have driven into us, allowed the soldiers to drive painful nails into his feet and his hands. And Jesus endured the jerk of the pain that came when they dropped that cross into the hole in the ground. Jesus suffered the excruciating pain as the nails tore through his flesh and his hands and his feet. He suffered as his blood bled out of his nail-teared, torn wounds. And Jesus struggled as he struggled for every breath. And Jesus felt alone when his Father had to turn away because how it looked to him bearing all of our sins. To where Jesus cried out, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" But he hadn't. And Jesus breathed his last. God demonstrated his love for us in this. While we were still sinners, he sent Jesus, his Son. He sent his Son, his sinless, spotless Lamb, to bear the punishment, to pay the price for the sins that we deserve to pay for. And just in case you think it was easy for God to send his Son to die, because, I mean, he's God, he can handle it, sit under the cross of Jesus for a while, see his suffering, hear his struggle as he bears our sins, and then tell me just how easy you think it was for the Father to watch his Son to die for us. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son." For God so loved the world, everyone of all time is placed in this world, including you and me, that he gave his one and only Son to be nailed to the cross, to be nailed, to be punished, to pay the wage, the price for our sins. Do you realize all that Jesus did for humanity, for me, and for you on that cross? Do you realize all that Jesus did for humanity, for me, for you, when he bore those nails? This is the Jesus spoken of in Isaiah 53. It says in verses 4 and 5, "Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows." In 5, "He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed." This is the Jesus spoken of in 1 Peter 2, 22-24, that says, he committed no sin. At the end of 24, he himself though bore our sins, and by his wounds you have been healed. A while back, a group called FFH did a song called On My Cross. These are some of the words. How wide is your love that you would stretch your arms and go around the world? And why for me would a Savior's cry be heard? I don't know why you went where I was meant to go. I don't know why you loved me so. Those were my nails. That was my crown that pierced your hands and your brow. Those were my thorns. Those were my scorns. Those were my tears that fell down. And just as you said it would be, you did it all for me. After you counted the cost, you took my shame, my blame, on my cross. John 3:16 adds, whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. If anyone comes to the Lord Jesus to that cross, they come and they confess their sins, ask for forgiveness for their sins, repent and turn from the sins, and invite Jesus into your heart and life as your personal Savior and Lord, God will forgive you your sins. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. You have come to Jesus as your Savior and Lord. Then as Jesus stood before Thomas and revealed that he had no more nails, the nails he did have held him no more. Jesus stands before you right now, and he wants to proclaim to you, you have me, you also have no more nails. Amen? He, your Savior, sinless, spotless Lamb of God, has taken the nails for you. He, your Savior, has paid the price and punishment for your sins, and through his sacrifice, his forgiveness, you have, say it, no more nails. And Jesus tells you, because I died, because I was nailed for you and for your sins, what held you doesn't hold you any longer. Thomas, I want you to put your finger in the place where I was held. I want you to know that what held me doesn't hold me anymore. And if you have confessed your sins and you've come to Jesus, you have, again, no more nails. Your sins don't hold you anymore. God sent Jesus to bear your nails, and now it's time to be free. Amen? If you ever think about looking back on your past, on your sins, or if a friend such reminds you of some things you've done you've asked forgiveness for, or Satan, or even your own self, such reminding those of you, I want you to proclaim loudly in the face of God, in the face of all around you, what? No more nails. All my sins have been died for, paid for, washed away, forgiven, and the nails were nailed to that tree, that cross, on Jesus Christ for me. Shout it, no more nails. All of my nails were driven at the cross. All my shame died at that cross. No more nails. I want you to reach out one finger and touch the center of your palm on your other finger. And I want you to say this. This is where the nails were. No more nails. Your sins have been forgiven. There's a neat thing coming up that says, it's a picture that says, it's for all of us math majors here. Yeah. One cross plus three nails equals forgiven. Amen? No more nails. Do not let anything or anyone continue to remind you of any of your nails. Of your nails. Listen to what a gentleman named Craig Wassenborough has written. I am wholly deserving of all the consequences that I will in fact never receive, simply because God unashamedly stepped in front of me on the cross, unflinchingly spread his arms so as to completely shield me from the retribution that was mine to bear, and repeatedly took the blows. And I stand entirely unwounded, utterly lost in the fact. While his body was pummeled and bloodied to death by that which was meant for me and me alone, I have not a scratch. No more nails. Say, he is risen.
He is risen.
No more nails.
No more nails.
For Jesus, no more nails, and for you, no more nails. Act after Jesus showed himself to Thomas and Thomas realized all that had been done, Thomas just said these words, and they're freedom words. Please look at it. My Lord and my God. Say it. My Lord and my God. Go out today, say no more nails for Jesus, no more nails for me. My Lord and my God, I praise you on this resurrection day for all that you've done for us. In Jesus' name we pray. All God's people say,
amen. Amen.